Good morning to all of you. Thank you for joining this morning. Thank you for being part of our virtual church. We hope that very soon we will be able to meet and have services once again in person. And those that wish to will still be able to join us in this virtual space. But this morning we come together again to worship and to give thanks to our God and to draw nearer to his presence and to his love. And so now we start by opening in prayer. So let us pray. Dear God, we give you thanks for your many blessings and for your great love that you give to all of us. Be with us and draw nearer to us. And let us on this morning come before you and acknowledge your presence and your love within us. We ask this in your name. We pray the collect for today, 29th of August. O God of eternal light, your word is truth. Make us quick to listen and slow to speak, that the word implanted in us will take root to nourish all we say and do. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
From the book of Mark, chapter 7, reading verses 1 to 7, 14 and 15, and 21 to 23. Some Pharisees and teachers of the law who had come from Jerusalem gathered around Jesus. They noticed that some of his disciples were eating their food with hands that were ritually unclean. That is, they had not washed them in the way the Pharisees said people should. For the Pharisees, as well as the rest of the Jews, follow the teaching they received from their ancestors. They do not eat unless they wash their hands in the proper way, nor do they eat anything that comes from the market unless they wash it first. And they follow many other rules which they have received, such as the proper way to wash cups, pots, copper bowls, and beds. So the Pharisees and the teachers of the law asked Jesus, "Why is it that your disciples do not follow the teaching handed down by our ancestors, but instead eat with ritually unclean hands?" Jesus answered them, "How right Isaiah was when he prophesied about you. You are hypocrites, just as he did. These people, says God, honor me with their words, but their heart is really far away from me. It is no use for them to worship me because they teach man-made rules as though they were God's laws." Then Jesus called the crowd to him once more and said to them, "Listen to me, all of you, and understand. There is nothing that goes into a person from the outside which can make him ritually unclean. Rather, it is what comes out of a person that makes him unclean. For from the inside, from a person's heart, come the evil ideas which lead him to do immoral things, to rob, kill, commit adultery, be greedy, and do all sorts of evil things, deceit, indecency, jealousy, slander, pride, and folly. All these evil things come from inside a person and make him unclean." Hear the word of the Lord.
Very strong reading for us in our gospel reading this morning. Probably a passage we all know very well. But what does it really mean to each of us? How can we really take it and understand it and live as God calls us to do? You know, you might have seen from time to time arm wrestling. And arm wrestling competitions take place. And you would think that a person who comes and sits at the table with huge, big, bulging muscles might be really strong and really good at arm wrestling. But from time to time, you might have seen a video on YouTube or some other means of media where some tiny little person comes along and demonstrates phenomenal technique and is able to arm wrestle a huge person with much greater muscle mass and strength. It's all about the technique. You see, we can also wonder sometimes about people who lift motorcycles to get onto the center stand. You see, it's a special technique of getting a very big, heavy motorcycle up onto its main stand. It's all about timing and shifting body weight and putting as much pressure on the stand where the part which you put your foot on, so that it catapults it and uses human leverage to be able to get it up to be the place where we want it to be. You may have watched a shot putter. And at one point, the man who held the world record for shot put was a very small, tiny, skinny little man, which seemed so totally different from what you would expect of a person who is very good at shot put. But again, it was about the technique that the man used. And he had developed a skill of being able to get a technique right that he could push the weight of the shot much further than many people who are perhaps twice his size and twice his muscle strength. Many of these sports demonstrate for us that it is technique. And sometimes we look at people and think, no, at this sport, they must be pretty useless. But yet they show us something totally different. Because you see, we judge from what we see. We look at a person and make a judgment call without being prepared to wait and check and see what can they actually do. And people will judge us just as probably we sadly do tend to judge other people. You see, God tells us in the scriptures that God does not judge us from the outside, but God sees what goes on the inside of us. God knows our motives and what direction we take. And God knows why we do what we do, because our Lord understands us better than we will ever understand ourselves. And God sees people from what they are and who they are on the inside and doesn't judge from the appearance or the outside. You see, the Lord knows us and knows us intimately in our thinking, in our behavior, and in what we actually do. And today we are finding in the scriptures our gospel lesson, which was read for us today, that the people are judging Jesus. They are judging Jesus and his disciples on their actions of what they see take place. And they are quite put off because Jesus and his disciples are not doing the ritual washing, which is what the Jews taught and expected. You see, what God had intended for being good hygienic practices of washing your hands before you eat, which now in COVID, of course, we understand perhaps more than we ever have before. But they had developed hugely complex ways of washing and dipping elbows and lifting your hands up in a certain way to dry them. And you see, none of this made anything important. And the people thought they were being religious and doing what God expected them to. But Jesus knew that these were human rules that had been made and created and held people bondage by the things that were not necessary, that had no ability to change people on the inside. You see, God is interested on who we are. And God is interested in our development of our character, our personalities, and who we are and who we become. And God wants us to become the best we can possibly be. The disciples are judged, and Jesus is judged, and Jesus reacts to what they say when they come in judgment to him. The question for us today is, do we judge God? Pharisees and Sadducees judged Jesus. They had an idea as to who and what the Messiah was going to be. They determined who and what the Messiah was to be. You see, we can't put God in a box. We can't go and label God and put God and define him and trap him into a specific routine or order. And you see, the question for us really today is, do we judge God? And if many of us are truly honest and really think about it, do we not judge God, just as the Pharisees judged Jesus on that day? It's so easy for us to turn to our Lord and to say to our God, we've prayed, but God did not answer. God doesn't listen to our prayers. That's natural for us to feel that. But I ask you, are we not judging God? Sometimes we could have physical pain in our bodies, and we can ask God to heal us and take away that pain. But God does not do that. And so what do? We say God doesn't love us. And you see, if we're going to base our relationship on God, upon what we get out of God, we could end up being very disappointed. But you see, as Christians, we reach that point of maturity of putting our faith and our trust in our God totally. Whether God heals us or whether God gives us the grace to endure what we need to endure. You see, it's so easy for us to turn to God and to blame God when we don't get what we want, because we like to manipulate God rather than realizing who we are to the Lord. God cannot love you less. And just because if we pray we don't get something does not mean that say that God is necessarily punishing you or wanting to try and withhold his goodness to us. God is the God of goodness. And how do we judge our God? Do we judge him as accepting God for who God is and realize that God can use whatever circumstances in our own lives to change us and mold us and let us become what God wants us to be? You see, we very easily judge ourselves. And it's easy for us to say that we are not good enough, and that God is not going to want to see us. And we are so bad at being Christians that we are going to even go to hell. And I've heard people say things like this. But you see, what we need to accept is what God has done for us. You see, Jesus looked at you and looked at me, and Jesus couldn't help but see the guilt and the sin. And what did Jesus do? He decided not to condemn us, but said he would take away that sin and he would make us perfect because he would take our guilt and our sin away. You see, Jesus looked at us and he can see us and see the dirt inside our own lives, but he decided to make us clean. And all we have to do is accept that forgiveness which Jesus is offering every human being, that Jesus came into this world out of his love to die and make us clean. Now, sadly, we reach that point where often we try so hard to live the Christian life. And we can try so hard to do the things that we know God would like us to do. And sometimes we sin and still get it wrong. You know, it's a little bit like our dishes. We dish up our dinner, we eat our fill, we take the plates, and they have to go back to the sink. But they get washed and cleaned and washed with the soap to remove the oil and dirt. They get dried, get put back in the cupboard for us ready and clean for the next meal we need to have. And Jesus has done this for us. That we know that even when we sin, God's forgiveness will still be given to us. But it is our task as Christians to work against the power of evil and against temptations, that we learn to live and conduct ourselves as God would want us to. You see, we can look beautiful and shiny and magnificent on the outside, but it's what's on the inside that truly matters. For what is on the inside is what ultimately comes out. Who we are on the inside comes out in the way in which we treat people, the way we talk to people, and you see, our actions speak very loudly in this world today. And so I ask all of us, as we are challenged, our Christian faith is not just about right theology, but about right living, in right relationship with God and right relationship with other people. And it's also about our right thinking. See, we often are driven by our thoughts. You see, one of the most powerful of the Ten Commandments is perhaps the one that is least preached about, where Jesus instructed us that we have heard the Ten Commandments, and the Ten Commandments, the tenth one that says, do not covet. And it's a difficult word to understand, because to covet means to so strongly desire something that it drives us into a sinful action. To be tempted is not sinful, but to dwell on that thought of the temptation that leads us ultimately to actions and leads us to ultimately to sin. What God wants us to do is to be able to be changed. And in our life, as we struggle against sin, the devil, and the problems of the world, and all that we are called, and all that is unrighteous in God's sight, we are also called to shape ourselves by the work of the Lord, by reading our scriptures and knowing what is God's ways, and for the goodness of those around us, and for us to realize what our thoughts are all about. Our thoughts can drive us closer to God, and our thoughts can drive us closer to doing the work and ministry God calls us to do as his Christian people. And for us today to realize that our sins are dealt with and washed and cleaned. And who we are on the inside, do we reflect and let the light of God shine through us to other people in the things we say and in our actions and in what we do? Or are we all just about talking without actions? Our reading today is also takes us to the book of James, where James writes us and writes to each of us to tell us that I would show you my faith by our actions. And you see, it is often true, our actions often speak much louder than our words. Our Christian faith has to be one that's put into practice and put into the realities of the world in the good that we do, because we make ourselves available for God to use to help and better other people's lives. Today, let us be challenged by the own dirtiness within us to confess our sins and ask God to forgive us, to wash us clean and make us perfect. And let us also try and keep the inside of our lives, in our thoughts and in our actions and in what we do, to keep them righteous and pure like the Lord would have us be, and let us be changed to become clean vessels that God can fill us with His goodness, and His goodness can overflow to others. As we bring this month of compassion, this month that we often see as Women's Month, for us to stretch out and appreciate the ladies and what women have done and their contribution that they have been made and their compassion that so often speaks so strongly to all of us. Let us also be changed by their actions and be moved closer to our God and to each other in all we do. And may God bless us as we welcome Jesus Christ into our lives again. Amen.
Let us pray. Creator God, we surrender ourselves to you and opening our hearts, understanding to your will to be done. As we devote this special time of prayer, we deepen our soul, our well-being to you, Lord. Come, Lord, we present the needs of the world, especially during this difficult time we face because of the COVID-19, which have caused too much suffering, sadness, fear, uncertainty in the world. Let us as humans respond differently to the pandemic by wearing our mask and encouraging each other to be vaccinated. Creator God, we stand before you. We realize how wounded we are, sinful, and we have limited our human response to you, God's love. Bring us together, Lord, as St. Margaret's parishioners. Make us the light of the world. To our children, our youth, women and men. Make us strive to support our legend in different ways. Almighty God, we glorify your name through the different gifts you have given us, not forgetting our brothers and sisters who are blind, deaf, handicapped, those who suffer from mental sickness. We pray for those in prisons, the refugees, those living in gang violence, our brothers and sisters in Afghanistan, fleeing terror. As we come towards the end of commemorating Women's Month, enlighten with wisdom those who teach and those who learn to spread the awareness about gender violence and child abuse. We draw closer to you, Creator God. We ask for forgiveness and for your grace to accept it. We pray for peace, Lord. Transform our lives into a gift of peace to others and giving. Lord, in your mercy, we end our prayer with the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
May the peace of God, which passes all understanding, be in our hearts, in our minds, and in our actions. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless us and keep us and empower us to live righteously through the work of God's Holy Spirit. Amen.